Hi, my name is Daniela Bota. I'm the Medical Director of Neurological Oncology at University of California, Irvine. It is my pleasure today to talk to you about modern treatments for malignant glioma patients. We are situated in the Chao Comprehensive Cancer Center at University of California, Irvine, where our patients are welcomed by our staff. When we talk about our brain tumor team, many times we think about neurological oncology and neurological surgery, and this is where I'm going to be concentrating my talk on today. I want to introduce you to my colleague, Dr. Frank Su. He is also the director of the surgical part of the brain tumor program. But I think it's equally important to remember that a brain tumor team, a neuro-oncology team, it's comprehensive and multidisciplinary. So here I want to mention all my colleagues in neurological oncology, neurological surgery, radiation oncology, neuroradiology, pathology, rehabilitation, psychiatry and psychology, nursing, social work, and dietitian. And I think it's so important to remind everybody that's interested on brain tumors, to our brain tumor patients, to our brain tumor families, that all those people are working together in order to provide the best outcome for all our patients that are under our care. So what is our goal? We like to use the advanced science on which we are involved to improve patients' outcomes. And when we think about patient outcomes, we think about two main goals. We want to increase our patient survival, and we want to bring our patients on being long-term participants on their life and on their families. But in the same time, we talk about maintaining and even improving their quality of life. So keeping those things in mind, let's see how can we achieve them together, patient by patient, family by family. When we talk about brain tumors and we think about what is the current standard of care, it always comes on a triad of surgery, radiation, and chemotherapy. What about surgery? We know that surgery in all the forms, including neurosurgery, has progressed and advanced through years. What we always want to remember for the surgery of patients with malignant gliomas is that the gold rule is do not harm the patient. The tumors have to be resected, if possible, in almost totality, as close as we can come to what we call gross total resection, but that should never come to the price of deteriorating the patient condition and declining their quality of life. So this is our goal. The question is, how can we achieve that goal? The things that we as medical neuro-oncologists are involved in are related to the pre-operative planning of those patients in order to be able to customize their surgical plan to their individual brain structures. We cannot take simple molds and apply them to such a complicated system like the brain is. What you see here are the images from one of our patients looking at the strength on his left foot. The white signal that you see, it's the tumor. The yellow signal that you see, it's where the neurons that coordinate the strength for the left foot are situated. What you can see with this study is that we can now tell this patient that the surgery will have minimal risk for the left foot strength, but it will also tell our colleagues in neurosurgery what is the best way on which they can approach this tumor without creating neurological deficits. Another tool in our augmentarium is the diffusion tensor tractography. It was the first technique we tried to find where the neurons are and to avoid the neurons that control different functions. With this technology, what we are trying to define is where are the fibers that connect different important brain structures and which transmit the information from one side to the other of the brain. The picture that you are seeing here looks at the transmission of the speech and the ability to understand spoken language. Very similar with what I showed you in the previous picture. Knowing where the red fibers are, as you can see in, on the screen, allows us to tell the neurosurgeons what is the area of safe surgery and what is the area on which, if it is approached, the patient's speech will suffer. Why all of those information? All of those informations now will gonna go and will be used during surgery. And the technologies that are going to be used during surgery, the most important function of those technologies will be not to harm the fibers and the centers that make us who we are, which guarantee us our quality of life and our function. It does not matter in the end if patients survive longer, if their survival is not associated with a better quality of life. We would like now to move in the future of chemotherapy after the surgery and the radiation is completed. And there are a few things that we are involved on at University of California, Irvine. We've been involved on those projects for years. Some of them right now are coming to fruition and they're transforming themselves on FDA-approved treatments. Others are in different other stages of research, either in our laboratories, in cells and animal models, or they are right now applied to patients in clinical trials. So the first step that we have to discuss again is personalized medicine. In the years before, we used to categorize all the tumors in a few categories based on how they looked under microscope. Recently, we learned that every patient's tumor has its own genetic makeup, which also allows us to determine the response to different chemotherapies, which will vary patient by patient. The modern clinical trials for new tumor-targeted drugs want to take into account the differences in the genetic structure of the tumor, making sure that the patients that get placed in a certain drug category and receive certain treatments are the patients that stand the most chance to respond to certain treatments. Another project that we've been involved on for many years is the development of alternating electrical field therapy, which is now called Optune. This therapy was approved by the Food and Drug Administration in October 2015 for newly diagnosed glioblastoma patients. The impact of this therapy on patient survival was important, was meaningful, was 5 months, and more patients lived 2 years or longer. This is a technology on which we have been involved since 2011, when the initial approval for recurrent glioblastoma was obtained. We are one of the highest volume centers in the nation, and very recently we participating in writing the guidelines, teaching other doctors what is the best way to use this therapy for the treatment of patients with newly diagnosed as well as recurrent glioblastoma. The new things coming on the treatment for glioblastoma right now are related to immunotherapy. We know that teaching the patient's immune system to fight cancer is achieving great successes right now in multiple cancer types, including lung cancer and melanoma. Clinical trials in major immunotherapy approaches are right now taking place over the nation. We have positioned ourselves as being one of the major immunotherapy hubs for this type of tumors, and we are right now very focused on developing our new strain of immunotherapy to be offered to the patients that do not have other means of fighting their tumors. The next therapy that we want to keep in the radar is the viral therapy. The important part about viral therapy is that it can specifically target the cancer cell and not to attack the normal cells of the brain or the other organs of the patient's body. There are different types of viral therapies. Some of them are delivering suicide genes, which will allow the cells that are infected with this virus, remember what we talked before, the cancer cells, to be attacked and killed either by the virus or by the immune system that comes and fights the cells that are carrying the viruses. So, I think in the end I would like to talk to you about how success looks like. And for a scientist and a physician, many times success looks like you could see on this slide. We started with a patient that was having a large tumor on the brain. We treated that large and aggressive tumor through a combination of treatments, including surgery, radiation, chemotherapy, new clinical trials, and now our patient is doing well and it's in remission. But I think for me, success looks like this. Looks like the team of physicians and the patients and their family working together to achieve better outcomes for patients with brain tumors. Thank you so much for giving me the time to present to you new therapies and new approaches for the treatment of malignant gliomas. If you have more questions or you want more information about the work that is taking place in our program, please visit our webpage or call our clinic.